PostCommodity Collective was founded in 2007, and its three current members have been working together since 2010. And today it's comprised of Kate Twist, Chris Paul Martinez, both of those guys are here with us tonight, and Raven Chacon, who unfortunately cannot make it. In learning more about PostCommodity Collective's work, I've been deeply impressed at how individually talented each and every member is. Chris Paul is a composer and a designer, with a PhD in rhetoric, composition, and linguistics from Arizona State University. His dissertation work identified him as one of the foremost experts on the impact of media and the internet on indigenous communities, which led to the Nation of Namibia bringing him in as a consultant to discuss the potential disruptive influences that the nation might have as they were increasingly becoming wired and how that might affect the indigenous communities there. Kate, one of the founding members of the collective, is in his day job a public affairs consultant specializing in health issues facing Native America. With clients including the Ford Foundation, Benton Foundation, National Congress of the American Indians, and many others, he performs outreach to tribes across the U.S. I've also learned that he finds great pleasure teaching professional development classes to art students, where he is currently teaching at Santa Fe University of Art and Design. Raven Chacon, the third member of the PostCommodity Collective, is an incredibly successful composer of chamber music. He, among others, he's actually had commissioned work by the Kronos Quartet, who FSU actually brought at one point to as part of the opening night's festivities, which is again how they're here with the museum exhibition. For the past couple of years, since 2004, Raven has taught hundreds of American Indian high school students living in reservations in the Southwest how to actually compose music. I mentioned all these individual talents and work to suggest that as remarkable as any of PostCommodity Collective's discrete artworks are, equally impressive is the work they put into forging what I consider an amazingly respectful equal and earnest collaboration. They've been able to pull together their very real individual strengths and focus them towards common purpose. And the results, as you will see, are incredibly sophisticated, thoughtful, and do poetically extend beyond what any member could or would have created on their own. They have been awarded grants from the American Composers Forum, Creative Capital, Art Matters, the Harpo Foundation, the Joan Mitchell Foundation, and the Native Arts and Culture Foundation. National and international exhibits include Contour, which is the fifth biennial of the moving image in Mechelen, Belgium, Nuit Blanc in Toronto, Canada, the 18th biennial of Sydney in Sydney, Australia, Adelaide International in Adelaide, Australia, the Scottsdale Museum of Contemporary Art in Scottsdale, Arizona, and their historic land art installation, The Colored Fence at the U.S.-Mexican Border. In regards to the last work, the film Through the Repellent Fence, a land arts film by Sam Wainwright Douglas, which is all about PostCommodity project, is actually premiering this Saturday at the New York Museum of Modern Art. Just to mention two highlights, upcoming highlights from this year, they're incredibly busy. But they've been invited to participate in the Whitney Biennial American Art, which happens every 2 years and is simply the most prestigious and longest running survey of contemporary art in the United States. They're going to participate in Documenta 14, which in this iteration is a collaboration between Germany and Greece. And it has a similar mandate to exhibit the best contemporary art from all across the world. And this occurs every 5 years. To be invited to participate is a great honor and accomplishment in its own right. Before I turn the microphone over to these guys, I should mention that if you're interested in actually seeing work made by PostCommodity Collective in person, I invite you to check out the exhibition Broken Ground, New Directions in Land Art at the FSU Museum of Fine Arts. We have a portion of Repellent Fence actually hovering in one of our galleries. Please come. The opening is tomorrow night at 6 p.m. If you can't make it, the show runs until the 26th. And now please join me in welcoming PostCommodity Collective.
Auditorium tonight. For those of you who I didn't have an opportunity to meet, be around. You just get to shake your hand. And I wanted to do that because I wanted to try to break the ice a little bit, you know, so that we can be engaged with each other. Because, you know, this is kind of a strange thing, and we want to try to break it a little bit. But I'm also very honored to be here with my brother and colleague, Cade.
Yeah, my name is Cade Twist. I'm from, my family is from Northeast Oklahoma. If anybody's been out that way, little towns like Bunch and Greasy and Locust Grove are where my folks are from. But I was raised in Bakersfield, California, and I'm currently living in Santa Fe.
And I was raised in the Upper Rio Grande Valley of northern New Mexico, and Mestizo. My families are from Dixon, New Mexico. Abiquín, New Mexico, from Velarde, and from Huachiponge, which is near the part of Santa Clara, Yipoto. And before we get started, we have some people we'd like to thank. It's a huge honor for us to be with you all tonight. And we'd like to thank Alice Palandino. Where are you, Alice?
There's an event in the museum, so she's going to sneak in.
Oh, sure! Well, that's okay, Maria. We want to thank Oscar, Dino, Craig, and the FSU Museum of Fine Arts. We also want to thank the Department of Art of Jeff Beekman and Carolyn Henning. So, and thank you all. Thank you all for being here on Friday night. So, one more thing. If you have any questions along the way, feel free to, you know, be as disruptive as possible. Because we don't want to be discussing and talking, and it's a lot more fun that way, I think. Yeah, so don't be shy. Yeah, it is Thursday, thank you. I was like, Friday. But yeah, please.
But yeah, make it as conversational as possible. In all honesty, joking aside, if you really do want to ask a question, we can address that on the fly in real time rather than at the end, because it's so much better if there's a really small conversation. So we'll start here. There's this like mission that we have, and it's something that's really important to us is to think about what 21st century colonialism is really about. It's not an era where we can point our finger at any one person or any one nation or any one corporation or anything, because we're all implicated as 21st century colonizers by our consumption. So we are trying to implicate ourselves. We're trying to step our discourse and indigenous discourse in general outside of that tired binary of us versus them, or Anglo versus indigenous, or Spanish versus indigenous, or French versus indigenous, or German versus indigenous, or whatever that may be. So it's really important, and I kid my students in my professional practices class, because I, you know, of course we have to write bios. And they look at that sentence, and they go, why would you include that in a bio? It's crazy. But that's part of it. It's, you know, there's different ways to communicate your intentions. Sometimes you have to hack language to do it, and create really crazy run-on sentences. But that helps. People tend to remember it for its awkwardness.
So post-commodities art functions shared indigenous lens and voice to engage the assaultive manifestations of the global market and supporting institutions, public perceptions, beliefs, and individual actions that comprise the ever-expanding multinational, multiracial, multi-ethnic colonizing force that is defining the 21st century through ever-increasing velocities and complex forms of violence. Post-commodities work to forge new metaphors capable of rationalizing our shared experiences within this increasingly challenging contemporary environment, promoting constructive discourse that challenges the social, political, and economic processes that are destabilizing communities and geographies, and connect indigenous narratives of cultural self-determination with the broader public sphere. So it's our honor to present to you tonight one working example of this statement, and how we operationalize this statement in a, through a publicly engaged work that we call Young Men's.
Has anyone ever seen these things? It's scary. Why don't you give them a reverse order online? This is an example of what it looks like if you were it. It's really cheap. But there's, and they don't work. And, my wife was running for the city of Tempe, Arizona at the time. She was talked to some of her colleagues about a bird pod we had, a fig tree, and those things would come and party in our yard when those figs were ripe. We're trying to get rid of the birds. And the facilities manager for the city of Tempe, now this is the city of Tempe, recommended that we buy one of these because it works. It really works. Well, we bought it, we put it in the tree, and it worked for about 10 minutes, and it was covered in bird shit. It didn't really work very well, but there's something really interesting about this. If you look at the colors, or many of the indigenous medicine colors are used this hemisphere, and if you look at the iconography that's being used, it's an old indigenous iconography called an open eye, and it's used by indigenous people from South America all the way up to Canada, so it demonstrates the interconnectedness of our hemisphere through cultural exchange. That's why that iconography is ubiquitous. So what we had was an ineffectual consumer product that was also a really wonderful indigenous ready.
So, you know, what's happening with this is that it becomes a metaphor for fast capitalism. The idea that part of our consumptive behaviors are centered around supporting and purchasing products that are meant to expire fairly rapidly is a way to create that market power that encourages us to go and spend more. And so, like one of the products, you know, that we're all really implicated in when it comes to this kind of market strategy is smartphone technology. And we're all replacing these phones every few years, even though they fundamentally do exactly the same as the very first ones were put on the market. And so we get the sort of benefit of spending our hard-earned money while trashing the environment at the same time. There's a really interesting tension to these balloons because we have a vehicle, a metaphor of fast capitalism, while at the same time, we're looking at these indigenous spiritual mediators. And so this was a really interesting object for us.
So, spiritual mediators, but also, just to slow it down just a little bit, became the first project of PostCommodity in 2007. We're sitting around the backyard looking at these, painting, doing nothing, realizing the ready-mades, and realizing we've got to do something with them. What should we do? We immediately had this idea, let's build a repellent fence. You know, we didn't know what that meant at that time, but it's important to know in 2007, let's build a repellent fence. It's so easy to say that.
So, you know, we do what we're all artists do. We start we're really inspired by these objects, and we want to do something really big with them. And so we decide, what does it mean to make an amplified version of these? So we took one that's like, the ones that you buy at Home Depot or on Amazon, they're about the size of a beach ball. And we made these 10-foot diameter ones, which you'll get to see if you go and visit the gallery. And we wanted to then find out, well, what happens if we put these balloons in different contexts? How does the public respond? You know, what does it feel like? What does it look like in scale relative to other things? And
how does it facilitate conversation?
Yeah.
It was really one of the challenges that we wanted to investigate. You know, how is this going to communicate our intentions? Or is it even possible to communicate our intentions? Is it something that's too loaded? Is it too difficult to read? So we floated one above Sheriff Joe Arpaio's jail. And this was about the time when they were herding immigrants, rounding them up, and they're doing the same thing once again. But it's when they were doing it in around 2005 to 2008. It was really brutal times in Arizona for brown people. People were getting arrested and pulled over in their cars, and illegal search and seizures, all justified by this idea that you're brown and you could be illegal. So we realize that by putting it here, one, it disarms conflict. We didn't have any arguments about a balloon. I guess Americans see a balloon, they don't want to fight about it. They just want to stare at it and imagine what it might mean. And that's exactly what happened. There wasn't one repugnant and violent act. Everyone is just curious. Why is this here? Why is it over the jail? So it's fairly successful as a communications tool.
But largely ineffectual. we try our darndest to scare away Western civilization, and it really didn't work.
Think of a 12-inch diameter, 10-inch diameter, it could scare away a bird, maybe a 10-foot one,
yeah.
Could scare away Western civilization.
So that was our first test, and then we decided to place it in another context. So, you know, this idea of like language and literacy and linguistics becomes really important in art, because you have the same object, right? But if you put it in different sorts of rhetorical situations or different political context, the word transforms, changes. So we have to be thinking about that as artists. Like we make a work of art, and its meaning is going to change from space to space, from context to context. And we're trying to understand this as artists. So we installed this in Canada at Manitoba Hydro. And this is the corporate headquarters of Manitoba Hydro, and this is an electric company in Canada who has been responsible for flooding thousands of acres of indigenous territory and traditional homelands, millions, for the purposes of creating hydroelectric energy. And so we were able to enter into a dialogue with Manitoba Hydro to talk about to talk about history and to begin to get a conversation going around accountability. And this is happening at a very interesting time in Canada, where there's a conversation going on that is tied to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And so we were able to take advantage of the social, political climate to begin to, you know, try to create symbols of accountability And so we got to fight this in the lobby of their corporate headquarters as a way of almost saying, hey, you know, we have this open eye. It's an eye of awareness. We're aware of what you've done, what you're about, and you know, we're kind of watching. And we're kind of beginning to demand some level of accountability.
And then from a pragmatic standpoint is another opportunity to look at a different design motif in terms of color, size, you know, everything, just to further research how this thing can, you know, look aesthetically. Still utilizing those fundamental tribal medicine colors, but really interesting process. And what is most interesting, I think, is not negotiating to get it into the lobby, but the fact that they were stewards of the piece. They had to care for it. And every 3 days they had to top it off with helium. So they have to fondle, you know, this accountability and keep it alive, keep it floating. And then, you know, so it was a really powerful process, you know, for us and for the folks that we talked about in that. And Winnipeg's really important politically in Canada because it is a city. It's like the functional equivalent of Phoenix or something. It's a really high population of Indian people, indigenous people. It's a very brown city and unmistakable influence. You know? So it was nice to be able to do a work like this in a city like that.
And there's something that is really important about that story that he just shared with us, is that artists have this incredible position in society to flip the script on power. And if you're strategic enough, you can really create fissures in the socio-economic cultural fabric of the world. And that requires incredible discipline and responsibility. You know, art isn't just about what's on the inside. It's about how we come to understand ourselves in relation to others. And that, it requires an incredible amount of responsibility. Responsibility that we're not seeing. For example, on Facebook, or you get the comment sections of, you know, op-eds, no respect, no responsibility, no leadership, no accountability. Leading up from the very citizenry to the higher echelons of power in the world. And so artists have this incredible opportunity, this incredible responsibility.
One final thing about this work that we learned as a collective, and I think it's important for a lot of artists, especially students, is we can only do this kind of piece through formal diplomatic channels. Like, we had to work protocols of that corporation to communicate. We had to follow procedures. We had to be patient. We had to withhold information that may have gotten us in trouble. We had to position the work so that it was generative and they could participate in that generative process. We had to extend an olive branch to them in a formal way that made them feel welcome being a steward of that piece and to feel like that responsibility was empowering, you know? So that was a kind of positioning that was really required. It was eye-opening, because you grow up as an artist thinking about, you know, all these guerrilla actions, you know, that everything has to be, you know, counter this or counter that. But you'd be surprised how effective you can be if you're working from within and creating that disruption, rather than from outside.
So, you know, so that's like the big question that perhaps you can ask yourselves as you're leaving tonight. What kind of artist are you going to be? Are you going to be an artist that polarizes society? Are you going to be an artist that tries to encourage dialogue across difference? Are you going to be an artist that creates oversimplified cultural models? Or are you going to be an artist that mediates complexity? Those are things to think about. And either one is really never, not really good or bad. But there are choices. there are choices you can make as an artist.
Could you talk a little bit more about that conversation that you had? Because as a collective, you must have had strong feelings about the hydroelectric dam. What is it like being subversive from the dam? Specifically, like what can you give some kind of example?
It really helps when it's within the framework of a major international exhibition. That really helps. Yeah, this is part of an exhibition called Close Encounters. At that time, it was the largest indigenous contemporary art exhibition ever staged anywhere in the world. And Winnipeg was the cultural capital of Canada that year, and they chose to host that exhibition because of it. So we had considerable political clout with this. But so rule number one is don't go into those rooms alone. You have no leverage by yourself. You have to have leverage from the community. So I think that was critical. The conversation itself was really straightforward, because we had the support of sponsors of that event, and Manitoba Hydro was one of them. So there was a way to use them as, use their accountability as sponsors of the event and open the event
but
to
specifically,
to them.
I guess maybe I'm not explaining myself well. Specifically,
if it was really easy.
Yeah, but how did you make them feel good about your piece?
That's a tough question. Because that assumes that they felt good about it.
You said you extended an olive branch. What was the olive branch you extended?
The olive branch was a collaboration, a care for a piece.
And the olive branch is the generosity of indigenous people, even willing to engage in a diplomatic dialogue with people who are going to ruin your lands. So it's this generosity of being willing to even engage without overt displays of anger or creating an us and them. I mean, creating a dialogue and collaboration so that at some point, Winnipeg Hydro becomes stewards of the peace. And there's meaning in that. Because although that might not make them feel good, but maybe it does. Maybe it's cathartic. Maybe it causes them the opportunity to reflect. Or maybe it's symbolically, it's a first step toward accountability. But the idea isn't necessarily for everybody to feel good. That's not the work of diplomacy. Hard work and very counter to the reptilian parts of who we are as humans. But the work is about oftentimes about the kind of disruption that allows new possibilities that we haven't seen before. And this kind of an intervention is something that is definitely new.
More specifically, it's really important to have people, community leaders, join you in a conversation like that. And so we've had a number of stakeholders that were participating in that process. And the goal was to establish a point of mutual, what's the word? Not mutual, mutual respect is one thing, but mutual respect and vulnerability is another. So we were trying to establish a sense of vulnerability across the table. And that was the vulnerability as artists, and allowing them to care for that piece. And then from their perspective, it was them allowing us to occupy space with our art. So it was really, it was beyond a quid pro quo type of relationship. It was truly about framing vulnerabilities and seeing it as an opportunity to co-intentionally overcome those vulnerabilities together. I think that's the nature of the conversation around that helps. All right. response. And, you know, that's the unfortunate thing about art is, you know, you can't gauge a response from a corporation, but you can gauge a response from the individuals that you're working with within that corporation. But there are various, you know, turf, you know, within the organizational framework. With those people, they really appreciated the fact that the artists were interested, because we weren't the artists, that we were interested in, you know, using their space and bringing that narrative to a larger public. Because that's a narrative that they are working on from a public relations standpoint to disarm. So they were really happy to have artists working with them to try to shift the dialogue towards something better. And I think after the piece, you know, nothing was communicated to us from them, but we did get a lot of community feedback. So not necessarily from the corporation, but definitely from the community. It was really, really positive. They really liked balloons in Canada.
Something that's really important to keep in mind is that when something like this happens, it's a very, for a lot of people, it affords the opportunity for peoples to feel a sense of dignity. There's something that's very humanizing. It's very humanizing to be accountable for mistakes. It's also very humanizing to be recognized when you've been a victim of those mistakes. And so I think that's one of the real, in that way, the balloon, it's not about recounting. It's about seeing. In fact, it's very, very effective.
Yeah. So we left this scenario knowing that the proof of concept was sort of taken to the next step. And we went into full fundraising mode. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just curious. You mentioned ready-mades. Do they play an important part in your work?
This did.
Or provide commentary, right?
For this piece, for sure. But we had never used ready-mades in this, you know, fashion format.
Gotcha.
But this, probably because we were saving it for this, because this is the first piece we saw and thought of, and we just didn't know what it was or how to do it. So we were probably holding off on using ready-mades to save that for this.
That makes sense.
I mean, we were dragging this around like abandoned luggage for 8 years. We had to live with it for a long time.
So, what we started to do was, we announced, after having done those studies, we going back to Arizona. Kid and I were living in Arizona at the same time during the early part of this 2000s. It was a series of propositions that were passed in the state of Arizona that were targeting everything from illegal roundups and deportations of immigrants. That meant that Mexican Americans were being targeted, the citizens were being subject to those searches, and there were bans on illegal education, banning of ethnic studies, just a whole series of policies that were the result of a white supremacist regime in the state of Arizona. So that has impact on us as people of color. And so we decided that our balloons needed to go to the border. We needed to go to the source, because we saw that the border was one of the most geopolitically contested spaces in the Western Hemisphere, and certainly one of the most highly militarized spaces as well. And so initially we had this idea that we would, you know, go guerrilla style and put these balloons up, and if originally then we have lots of conversations. What does that mean? What does that mean if these things are run parallel to the border, running the side? How are people going to interpret it? What does the appellant fence mean? So we're trying to think a lot about, what does it mean? What does it mean if we put it in different places along the border? So many unanswered questions. So what we decided to do is, you guys are tricky. So what we decided was, after having some more dialogue, we decided it wasn't that the fence had to run parallel with the border, it really had to intersect the border. Because here we have this object that is a metaphor for fast capitalism, and we're looking at how fast capitalism is creating certain disparities in different parts of the globe and forcing different kinds of migrations. And so so we started scouting lands all along the US-Mexico border. And we visited the border from the California-Arizona state line all the way to the New Mexico-Arizona state line. And we visited every bit of that border, being chased by Border Patrol the entire time.
And knowing that all they wanted to do was just talk with us and hang out.
I know. It was really stressful. Really stressful.
We just tried to be our pros.
It's very complicated. And a lot of anxiety. One of the things that drew us to the border was, you can see the Tohono O'odham Nation. Tohono O'odham Nation. And the thing about this Native American reservation is that it's the second largest land-based reservation in the U.S. The Navajo Nation is the largest. And you can see how it abuts right up against the U.S.-Mexico border. But it actually doesn't end there. The Utah people span all the way down south and are part of in Puerto Peñasco and then moving south along the Gulf of California. And this is a tribe that is split in half by the border. And so what we notice is that in the immigration debate, that there really isn't a indigenous perspective as part of that debate or part of that discussion. And so we started to think that maybe recount events might be a tool or a sort of mechanism that we can use to start to bring those voices into the conversation. So we started trying to find places where we might be able to install the fence. And we're going to start scouting, because we were thinking, there's all kinds of problems. Like, there are mountains, there's so many geographical challenges just with land alone. Like, where are you going to put this thing? And then you do find places where you're able to install it, where it's flat. But then you find that the political situation is untenable. That the proposal is untenable in certain political contexts. What we sort of realized is that we're a sort of political Goldilocks zone. Seen it in astronomy, all the probability around planets, they have to be a certain distance from the sun, they be in a certain Goldilocks zone in order for there to be life. Well, for a palm fence, it had to be a sort of political Goldilocks zone where all the right conditions were in place on both sides of the border in order to be able to host an ideal.
So what if the finding the Goldilocks zone is an easy way of saying it was an extensive multi-year public relations and public affairs engagement that involved two nations, two states, one in Mexico, one in Arizona, multiple counties, and two city jurisdictions. But before we got
languages.
So it was something that was a huge investment of resources, time, and strategy. And at the time, I was working with a public affairs firm, which I don't want to name because I made a video too. And there was our legal counsel at that public affairs firm, who I won't mention, but was a very nice gentleman. And he was working with the Department of Justice on a project called Fast and Furious. You all remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, not the movie. This is with weapons that were, you know, supposed to infiltrate the cartels. And we were supposed to be able to track serial killers. And it just didn't work out very well. Because in Douglas, one of the agents was found shot execution style and the weapon left there by his side. So the cartel knew from the very beginning that that wasn't going to work. But this person, my legal counsel, my firm, had a lot of knowledge, contacts, and relationships, and he knew the political landscape because he had been working with the Department of Justice down there for over 15 years. So we worked through this plan and developed it, and a couple of really important things came out of it that might be important for students to realize, you know, to think about is, one, this cannot be guerrilla action. We have to follow formal protocols, just like we did with Manitoba Hydro. We had to do this for all of the cities, all the jurisdictions that we were going to engage, tribal, non-tribal, both sides of the border. So this became a formal process of international diplomacy around this one idea. And that idea that we started with was creating binational collaboration and cooperation that acknowledged the connectivity of indigenous people historically and contemporarily. That was our entry point into the discussion. It got more complicated than that as we went through our organizing process. But that's where we started with this idea of demonstrating connectedness, historical connectedness, present connectedness. That's how simple it is.
And what we learned is that we were not alone. What happened was we came eventually to Douglas and Alameda, almost out of order. And what we realized is that, well, firstly, we met with the mayor of Douglas.
Who was a shoe salesman.
Was a shoe salesman. Yeah.
That was where our meetings.
We met him in his shoe store. And he was one of the first, well, he was the first person that we met that there wasn't any signs of fear in the idea. There, he didn't look at us like we were crazy. And he was, you know, pretty interested. And he directed us to meet the Mexican consulate. And we met the Mexican consulate. And we had the same kind of experience with the Mexican. Then the Mexican consulate escorted us into Alameda to go meet the mayor of Alameda. And she was totally, like, blown away and excited by the idea.
She pitched two other projects.
And she pitched two other projects to us, yeah. One of which we have a proposal in to do. And so what we realized was that this was a community that was that Goldilocks zone that we had been searching for, and later on down the road we began to understand why it was the situation was the way that it was. And so you can think of Douglas and Alameda as one single city divided in half by an iron wall. And so when the iron wall was put in place, people had to decide in the city on which side they wanted to live. Imagine somebody coming to your town and telling you, well, you better figure out what side you want to live on. And so what ends up happening is that some cousins choose this side and some cousins choose this side. So you have aunties and uncles on that side and grandma lives over here, and some U.S. citizens whose parents have been deported live in Alameda, the kids across the border every morning to go to school. And so you have this situation that is very dehumanizing, discouraging, and violent, and desocializing. And these communities, they know the psychological power of the law. And so what they did was they created local trans-border public policies, and they laid the groundwork for those policies in the form of a trans-border memorandum of understanding. And that memorandum of understanding stipulates a commitment by both cities to work and collaborate together at all levels of society. That includes culturally, politically, economically, and socially. And so, unbeknownst to us, very early on in the conversations, they saw our proposal as an opportunity to operationalize their MOU. And so as we started to get in deeper with them, we started to understand this. And as we're understanding this, the community is beginning to work with us to co-determine the meaning of the fence. And so one thing that we're really proud of about Recalling Fence, from a collective that wanted to do this guerrilla thing,
didn't know what this was.
Yeah, didn't know what this was, to beginning to kind of mature in a way, become financial diplomats. And really committed. We didn't want to be a bad nonprofit, because we think that that's what a lot of social practice art does, is that it creates a lot of bad nonprofits. And that's not what we wanted to do. We're from the borderland. These are our people. These are our indigenous cousins. And so what we wanted to do is we wanted to get it done right. So we took a lot of care in building trust and building relationships. And eventually, we were able to
the epiphany at these meetings.
Oh yeah.
The epiphany. There's a couple of them. I'll let you see. The first epiphany is that this is bigger than what our original premise was, which is to demonstrate the connectedness of indigenous people across the border. These are traditional homelands of indigenous people are still there. Their tribes may have been dissolved, or they may not have the legal authority of a tribe that has signed a treaty with the United States.
Undocumented indigenous people.
But in the narrative that we were in was trapped in the Tonawanda Nation. We were still thinking like American Indians. We weren't thinking like indigenous people. We were still thinking in a biased way. That because what we wanted to do was connect the Tonawanda Nation and do it on their reservation and have the conference there, because we wanted to connect indigenous people. Well, the whole damn place is indigenous people. And meeting with those cities and the conversations we had, they made that so obvious to us that this is so much bigger than what is American Indian. And we had to bridge that cultural chauvinism that I had myself by thinking of Tonawanda, and not thinking about the larger border and the cultural chauvinism that the Tonawanda had towards their own people in Mexico. They talked down to their brothers and sisters from Mexico. They did not acknowledge an elder who was monolingual. They didn't engage them in often. So those were the kinds of things that were happening, this whole time. And then we sit down at this meeting, and the way that they talk, the way they introduce themselves, they don't act like Hispanicized indigenous people. They act like indigenous people. And that's how they conducted their affairs. And for me, it just blew the whole project open. And this was the right place just for that reason alone, let alone that.
And it doesn't take long before the Hispanicized and Latinized mestizos, opata mestizos, remind us of who they are. And this is the thing, okay? are some rhetorical questions. How is it that a certain sector of society have branded themselves as nativists, have used that rhetoric of nativism to force a language of illegality and alienation upon indigenous peoples of the Western Hemisphere? I said I wasn't going to use a customer, but I just feel like how in the fuck did that happen? So, repellent fence now becomes about placemaking and remembering and building new public memory to begin to flip the script on some of these rhetorics that were subject of the borderlands.
And that's nothing we introduced in these meetings. That was introduced to us. That was told to us over and over and over again. So, not the smartest people in the world. It took them a few times to really drill it into our heads.
So what they told us was that this is offense, but it's more than just offense, or it's offense with a new purpose. That this is actually a suture. What this is doing is this is suturing the indigenous peoples of the Western Hemisphere, all peoples together again. There was a time when that law didn't exist. And there was a time when our indigenous ancestors traded and migrated and moved freely, north to south, south to north, always in search of better economic opportunity.
And where is this section of the San Pedro River Valley with the El Camino Real and everything? I mean, that is the oldest trade network of the Americas. Is going to that river valley.
So, I'm just curious, how are we on time?
It's going to pause right
now. Oh, great. We actually did. What we're showing here is we're showing the site of the installation. And so, this is Pieta right here. Our Pieta is much bigger than Douglas. Up north is Douglas, and this line right here represents the place where we installed the repellent fence. And so here's what part of the binational diplomacy looks like. Well, if you're an artist, right, and you have this idea, you sort of have the pieces and parts, and you talk to the community, but now come other aspects. Whose land is that? And how do we get permission to be on that land? And how to use that? Well, in the US side, it was easy because the city owned that land. And so we already had buy-in from the city administration of Douglas. In Mexico, that land was privately owned. And so we had to work through the city of Agua Prieta, and through the city we were able to get permission from the private landowners. But it goes even farther. Ownership, I'll get to you just in one second, but ownership goes farther than that. Landowners, they don't actually have control over their own lands. Border control. On the U.S. side is the one who has control over those lands. And in Mexico, it's the cartels and the coyotes. So we have to be able to have these dialogues where city administrators are crossing into the U.S., meeting with city administrators in Douglas, and vice versa. So city administrators moving back and forth the border to be able to leverage their networks that we could create this kind of 4 days of safety, 4 days of, you know, calling a timeout so that we could prepare grounds for what we refer to as indigenous reimagined ceremony. That we could bring these spiritual mediators into the space and we could all work together at the administrative but also the have a generative and productive dialogue across the difference.
Absolutely. And that land was definitely controlled by the cartels. And we were fortunate enough to be involved with a piece that was also relevant to the cartels. The cartels are people just like we are, and they're just as much anxiety and hatred towards the federal policies that created that wall. So they were very, very supportive of the project and definitely kept it safe.
We have a couple of questions. I think you had your hand up a while back. Established our relationships as family. And power of how we work. And it's also important to note that ideas are always the boss, both inside the collective and outside the collective. So it's not only what happens within the three of us, but it's in what we learn as guests in the places we visit.
Okay. One thing that's really a good takeaway is you don't go into a meeting and talk about process when you're talking about your work. How many of your students talk about process first, ideas second? Right? Like, I've been to so many crits all over the place, and I don't care how prestigious the school is, those students are going to talk about the process first. No one cares about your process. Everybody cares about your ideas. So you're going to have to flip that over. Because if we would have walked into this scenario and tried to talk about our process, that would have got it. We were able to go from this red line on a computer to this in reality because we talked about ideas. There was a discourse that was intentional. And when you have a discourse-driven art practice, you're able to connect your practice to an audience. If you have a process-based art practice, you can connect your work to a process. So you have to have that thought in mind about how can you communicate your work? How can you help people communicate your work on your behalf? That's by connecting to ideas that people care about, ideas that are shared among people. Work becomes a container for those ideas. All art is just a container for our ideas to facilitate dialogue and discourse. And that's that methodology that we provided to live by and work by in this project.
So, and you know, one of the things that's really important about the Indigenous Reimagined Ceremony and the work that we do is that our work is about positioning metaphors in society and not being didactic. Yeah, we do have a position in this. We're human. But that's, we try to create work that's also, it's influenced by our position, but also external to our position. And that it provides people with the opportunity to infer their hearts and their needs and their minds into what they're seeing and what they're experiencing. And so there, that, you know, that's the difference between what we did with recompense and what we're seeing with a lot of border art. A lot of border art is a protest. It's an activist movement that comes from a place of anger. And that's very important given the situation. Especially from the voices who can blame people for what they're feeling and what they're going through. But there's also got to be room for other ways of communicating. And so we think metaphor is one of the great mechanisms by which to bring co-intentionally with people, to recover knowledge, to create new knowledge. And so,
and positioning this work, when Crisoval is talking about we position metaphor, in this context, we were operationalizing a metaphor for this memorandum of understanding, this binational agreement. We were operationalizing a metaphor of cultural repatriation and also we were positioning this metaphor of collaboration and cooperation that cities could achieve through self-determined processes in ways that overcame the limitations of federal policies. The cities did something that the government was trying, that the federal government was trying to prevent. And one of the most simple examples of that was managing
of entry in Douglas doesn't have the capacity to process hazmat. So hazmat is not taken across the border through that port of entry until those two communities wanted helium to get across the border. And you know what happened? Helium got across the border.
They leveraged the very agencies implicated in the oppressive policies that they live under. They learned to leverage those very agencies to reflect their own community needs and desires. That changes the political landscape of the region fundamentally, psychologically. And so, one of the things that's really great about our conference is we oftentimes get asked, well, how is it still there? No, it was only up for 4 days. And people say, wow, you worked for 8 years to create something that only lasted 4 days? Well, no, this is just the manifestation of diplomacy that went on for 8 years. Fundraising type diplomacy that went on for 8 years, 3 years of intense diplomacy.
Stress mark.
But, you know, the thing that's important is that the Wobulims were a civil ceremony, a time to celebrate the achievement of the community. The community chose themselves for reimagined ceremony. And at the end, when these Wobulims went back, things, those relationships, those transborder relationships, they remained. Those political alliances remained. And something else happened that was super important. Was that a lot of the artists, one of the artists who took on a leadership role in doing a lot of community organizing, actually became the mayor of Douglas.
But he only has, he doesn't even have a VA, he just has a
school. You know, artists, it's almost not in our, even in our thinking that we could become a mayor of Douglas. Right? As artists? Or that we'd even be interested in doing something like that? But even being the mayor of a town is creative and artistic expression. And this man shows us this. His name is Mayor Uribe. And so we get notes every now and then from the community about their continued transborder activities. So anytime there's a fiesta or there's a holiday or something's going on, they do it together now. They don't do it separate from one another. And so, in a way, we created something that lasted beyond those 4 days of reimagined ceremony. And in some ways, it was just the fissure in time. It was just the portal. It just opened that portal up for 4 days to see it different, to make it new. And we cried. I'm about to cry right now. Because it was so powerful, the human spirit, people's generosity, in such a, you know, war-torn area. It's our country, that's our neighbor's country. And so for 4 days, we were human again. We were indigenous, we laughed, we ate together. Even people in poverty brought gifts in abundance. And so,
and it was quiet and it was peaceful.
And you could walk out there and
hear
be safe.
The city.
Children were part of it. And, you know, at the end of 4 days when the balloons came down, that door closed. And we saw Border Patrol move in. We saw the coyote activity happening. We saw people at the wall, children at the wall, begging and yelling at Kate and I to help them get across. We saw the whole thing collapse back in the sort of chaotic environment it was before we were there. So art can change a lot of things. But we also have to forget, we also have to remember that change is also a heavy burden for art to bear. I think we had a gentleman who had a question back there.
I was just interested in how you managed to liaise with the cartels to organize 4 days of peace.
All of this is, you know, fairly mysterious down at the border, and there is a lot of interconnectedness, and so a lot of that was taken care of by the government.
It's on our behalf. They refer to the cartel as the second bureaucracy.
Yeah.
And there's 0 degrees of separation. They walk among us, they walk among them.
And we're all implicated, all of us, as consumers, as people who turn a blind eye, we're all in it. And it becomes super, super legible that the implicatedness of people there in that region. You see yourself, but you see it in a really, really amplified way. There's no good guys or bad guys. It's a system. It's a market-driven, mediated system.
It's blind,
man. It plays a huge role in how we live every single day.
So, thank you. That concludes our formal part of the presentation. And we'll take questions now. Project and ways that reflected the school's best interests.
and we would be able to say things that reflected our best interests. We were happy with that. But in the process, we were able to purchase helium through their account at the rate that they had negotiated a number of years ago. So we were able to get helium at a fraction of the market rate. And that saved us over $72,000, just that partnership alone. So it's really about leveraging your assets. When you map power, you can't just map power. You actually have to engage the power and leverage it. And that's what we did all across the board. The cities became in-kind providers of security and marketing and public relations in a larger area. You know, there's so many value-added facets that come through partnerships.
The cities used the repellent meds as an opportunity to stage their first cross-border art walk. So they began to use it immediately as a way to reimagine their local economy and to build an economy around art, around arts practice, because there are huge cohorts of artists in that area, really talented people. And so,
it just in simple things like advertising. You know, nonprofits get a reduced rate, from commercial, private enterprises. So go through a nonprofit to place your ads, things like that. I mean, every little bit, when you lay out a budget that's like over $480,000, and you got to squeeze that down to less than $200,000, you've got a lot of partnering work to do. So our value added on the budget was much more significant than
And you got to do the work not only to establish the piece, but then to preserve it. So you have to think about, how do you, there's the whole PR component that also has significant dollars attached to it. So we also have to fill capacity by partnering there again in those sectors. So it's just a lot of outreach, a lot of relationships. A lot of telling and retelling and refining the story.
Fiercely loyal partners in Creative Capital and the Arts and Culture Foundation. They essentially came in on something that they didn't think was feasible. They told us that. They did not see us being able to do this, but they wanted to support the idea because they wanted us to go down trying as hard as we could. But to have people that are that honest and that fiercely loyal, and they followed up with media contacts, we were able to leverage their role of access in ways that we never thought would be possible.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you talk about leveraging the power of startup artists?
My biggest fear is that the social practice programs that are emerging
across the country are just going to make things worse.
Yeah.
They're going to create, they're going to transform artists into dysfunctional nonprofit organizations that are doing work that is exploitative for themselves and the communities and trying to advance. So it's, and there's some ethical concerns that I think we should all have for these social practice approaches that are something that you can't really create. You can't create an algorithm for community engagement. These communities are really complex systems, and they are always oscillating in terms of ideas, and policy, and procedure. I mean, it's a dynamic, living, breathing system. So you can't have like a A plus B equals C squared. You know, you just can't. You can't do that. You really have to investigate the community itself. Find out what its interests are, and if you can align your interests with their existing interests and add value to it and demonstrate that value-added process in a coherent way, then you can get those meetings with people. You can start leveraging their resources and power behind you. But getting that, making that happen, is a complicated song and dance. And not to mystify it, but it takes time. And that there's no substitute for time.
There's a driver in your conference that is about critiquing social practice. And that has a direct tie to who we are as indigenous peoples. Because we've been the subject of research since the very beginning. The very beginning of colonization. We've had this sort of paramilitaristic researchers coming into our communities and misinterpreting our knowledge. And categorizing it, and putting it in economies, and controlling representation, using knowledge as a weapon. And so, we see that same risk repeated in social practice. And so we set out to create a working example to try to mitigate the possibility of that becoming a real reality.
One example of this, why there isn't a guidebook for leveraging power, this project was done without any contracts. It was done with handshakes.
All verbal. All oral tradition.
Every bit of it.
When we tried to ensure the peace, we had a very hard time. Because we live in such a litigious society in America that we actually had to ensure it on the U.S. side. We have to do it in Mexico, we have to do it on the US side. And when Kate called the insurance agent that was recommended to us, just remember hearing Kate's voice. I remember hearing the voice coming through Kate's phone. What do you mean you don't have any written agreements with the cities? It was because we used our traditions as a way to build these agreements. It was also very strategic because there is no paper trail. So it allows people to feel a lot more comfortable with engaging something that is, you know, positioned at the very site of controversy. At the same time, one of the things that we're really proud of, I was sharing with Jeff today after lunch, was that this, and I shared a little bit earlier, this project was a manifestation of ideas and conversations that took place in three languages. So that's something remarkable because language is so porous. Even when we speak the same language, we still misunderstand each other all the time because it's so fragile and porous. And let alone to have to do it across languages, there are meanings and ideas that don't exist in other languages. You actually have to invent a language. You actually have to invent new words and new expressions in order to approximate what is being said in another language. And despite all that complexity, we managed to create a situation where over a dozen of these verbal agreements, and not one single one of them failed. That says something. That says something about literacy, about reading and writing.
One did fail.
obviously that we live in this moment that we are in, sadly, physically, this portal is no longer available to exist. So have you seen that between the moment of interest, you know, 4 days of when it ended, and now, and it's going to change because policy or effective
going? Yeah. You know, we articulated a little bit of that, but when the portal closed, not everything went back to normal. Some things got stuck. Some aspects of the portal remained, sort of got more bigger this time. And that's where it goes back to the cities now collaborating on festivals together. They have their financial art block. The artists became the city administrators. And so those things changed the political landscape of that region, you know, fairly dramatically. Go through these over and over and over and over again for a really long catalyze these kinds of changes, but we have to be able to respond in a way to the noise, but not let it dishearten us. We have to find a way to feel strong.
Give you an example of incremental change, right? When I was born in 1971, the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma didn't exist. It had been terminated by the federal government in the late 1800s. So we did not exist. Now, the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma is one of the most successful tribes in the United States. We have we run our own healthcare system, we run our own schools, we do everything.
The linguistic community of tens of thousands of Cherokee speakers.
So we went from no political identity to being a nonprofit organization to being the chair of the nation in my lifetime. That's incremental change. Now, if I was to wake up in 1980 and go, well, shit, you know, what is really going on? We don't really have anything, do we? It would have been an honest assessment, but it wouldn't have been true because a lot had changed since 1971. Yeah, so that's the kind of mindset that, just as Chris Sobol said, we're being taken away from. At the end of the day, the sun still rises and sets and rises in 24 hours.
A lot has changed. You know, when I got to Arizona, that the state was politically very conservative, and it's implicated on all these racist policies. And over time, it took over 20 years of me being there and changed, political change. Eventually, Sheriff Joe Arpaio was voted out. And the state teetered on red to blue. And, you know, we're not about partisan politics. We see ourselves, we see that as all part of an outcome of a very negative history that has impacted our people in a very negative way. But there is change. We can't turn a blind eye to progress because we have a bully for a president or an abuser for a president. If that's how we perceive them, not everybody perceives them as such. But change is slow, change is dirty, and change is painful and disruptive and hard. Just have to remember it takes a very long time.
Up and talk to them directly?
Yeah. Cool.